Thank you so much. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath po. I am always glad to be with Shekinah. This is among the few churches we're in. It's okay, I think, to share some heavy stuff. And because I see Shekinah as a church with a lot of intelligent people, I like to preach in front of intelligent people. Kasi pwedeng laliman konti yung pag-aaral. It's really a blessing for us here. And I've seen several familiar places. Thank you so much, Sister Noemi, for the invitation. Actually, last May pa ito. Has been last May. I was supposed to be with you here, but for some circumstances, I nag-alanganin ako that time. But this time, by God's grace, we are happy. I'm here with my wife. We're happy to be worshiping the Lord together with you. I bring to you greetings from the Ministry of Amazing Facts Philippines. It's quite difficult for me recently to be taking outside appointments kasi we are managing, like, I'm also an elder of Manila Center. And I'm also managing Amazing Facts Philippines. And last batch ng PAFCO training, nagkaroon kami ng church plant, isang unentered territory sa Grace Park, Caloocan. First time po. So now we have a congregation there, so minamanage namin yon. And then, other than that, lumipat kami ngayon sa PPH from Manila Center. We are now headquartered in PPH. We also have our own, tinatawag namin doon na transient church. Because we just operate when there is a PAFCO training. And then, 2 weeks from now, we are also gonna help in another church planting project. Actually, ano na siya? Mission group na siya in F. Carlos. Maybe you're familiar with that. Pero they reach out to us so that they can, by God's grace, become a company na pagkatapos ng ating gagawing evangelism doon. So please pray for the Ministry of Amazing Facts Philippines. We are working with the church to be able to plant churches by God's grace. But as the Lord gives us opportunity, then we can share the gospel and share the Lord's message to various churches as well. I was struggling and thinking about what I would talk about with Shekinah. Because when I try to look at my list of sermons that I have already completed in the past, naisip ko, parang marami na akong na-share dito sa Shekinah. And pangit naman kasi, nakakalimot ako, I forget which I shared to certain churches. And I thought, baka magkamali ako ng pili, baka maulit ko. Isipin nila, wala na kayang ibang sermons, Brother Kevin? Anyway, I struggled on picking a topic for today's study. Because of all the busyness kasi, I make it a point kasi when I go to churches and preach, I ask the Lord, Lord, what do you want me to share to these people? And the Lord was convicting me about something. But sabi ko sa Panginoon, Lord, I don't have time to make a sermon. No time. So I thought, ang plano ko talaga, ang i-share ko dito, one of my lumang mga sermon. Sorry about that. But then, nang nag-follow up si Sister Noemi sa akin, the Lord was really convicting me, don't, ano that. And so I told her, hindi pa ako sigurado. I'm having double thoughts about it. Actually, ang sakit na ng ulo ko nun because I was fighting with God because I don't want to make a new sermon. I just want to share an old one. Until the Lord really convicted me, no, share this. And I thought, okay, sige na. Then that's when I told Sister Noemi that I'll be sharing with you today Jesus, the perfect example. Well, this is an important study, so I would request you to pray for me as I would be sharing. And let us pray for each other that the Lord will enlighten us in our study today. By the way, since I'm here naman, let me just have a short plug. we have already started with PAFCO batch 17 na po yung PAFCO ngayon. And then we will continue on until hanggang December na po yung current batch ng PAFCO training. But we're hoping to be able to start another training session ng PAFCO this coming January of next year. That will go on from January until the first week of June. We have two courses na pwede pong ma-avail ninyo. Because ang requirement lang naman is dapat Seventh-day Adventist po kayo. At least 1 year baptized. And then as long as you are Seventh-day Adventist, 1 year baptized, then you can join the training. We have two courses. We have the full course and we have the I Preach. Yung full course, you must stay there in the campus and be with us for 3 straight months. And then 1 month, we will be deploying you for OJT. However, we have a special program para po sa mga working people. That is what we call the I Preach program. Some of you have, I can see here, have participated in that one, in our I Preach program. UP Diliman, UP Church, if you're familiar with UP Church, we've also worked with UP Church. Last batch, nagpadala sila ng 5 to be trained under our I Preach program. Kasi yung I Preach program, every Sunday lang po iyon. So you can join every Sunday. Ang specialization po nun is public evangelism. Now, some of you have joined our previous program, which is I Preach. That was about personal evangelism kasi yung I Preach about how to give Bible study and so on. Pero yung, I Share palang tawag nun, yung personal evangelism and giving Bible study. Pero what we are offering right now every Sunday is I Preach. That's focused on public evangelism. How to preach, how to make a sermon, how to conduct public evangelism, and preach the three angels message po. That's what Amazing Facts Ministry carries, the complete three angels message. We don't carry the shortcut message because we believe that the message that will prepare the world for the soon coming of Jesus is the three angels message. And that's what we are training our graduates to share to the world. Right now, I'll be sharing with you Jesus, the perfect example. Let us pray and ask for the Lord's help. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you for giving us this time to study. We ask now that you will be with us, that you will enlighten us, prepare our hearts and mind to be receptive of your word, and especially we pray, dear Lord, that it is the Holy Spirit who will teach us today. Guide us and help us to recognize your presence in the loving name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Our time is 11:07 a.m. So that I can see here in my clock. Okay. Now, Jesus, the perfect example. When we go around in different places, at least here in the Philippines today, we can see a statue. In a lot of places, you can see it in schools, you can see it in government centers. What do you think that statue would look like? Most likely, what you will think of is the statue of Jose Rizal, isn't it? Yes. Why is it that it is in public schools, in colleges? Why do we see the statue of Jose Rizal there? Because people think that he is worthy of emulation. He is a good example. Di ba? Kaya nga palaging pinapakita sa mga estudyante kasi gusto, ito yung aspiration. Matalino. Kahit ganon. Pero, may ganito at may puso. And he sparked the Philippine Revolution. Not with arms, but with a pen. Kaya, well, Jose Rizal is our example. Nevertheless, if you're familiar with history and you're familiar with the background of Rizal, you will realize that he is not actually a perfect example. You know, he is involved with what? Promiscuous relationships? And other things. So, yeah, Jose Rizal may be a good example, but certainly he is not the perfect example. And so, I present to you today the perfect example for us all. And let's read about that in the book of 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. Open your Bibles there. 1 I want you yourself to see this with your own eyes, not from my screen, but from your own Bible. Kaya pakibuksan po yung inyong Bibles. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 21. Okay, I can see some of you opening your Bible. Very good. Please open your Bible or else you will be bored, you'll be sleepy, and you will think it's my fault. But for you to enjoy, cooperate. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 21, I would read. For even here unto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. So notice here what the Word of God is telling us, that Jesus lived to give us an example. Here's the text now. This time, look at the screen. It says, an example. Who is our example according to the Word of God? Jesus. Now, let me read for you. This time from the Spirit of Prophecy. Child Guidance, page 475. Christ's perfect example and the grace of God are given him to enable him to train his sons and daughters to be sons and daughters of God. Meaning, the Lord gave Christ's example so that man can train their sons and daughters to be sons of God. It is by teaching them line upon line, precept upon precept, how to give the heart and will up to Christ that Satan's power is broken. Anong dapat itinuturo ng mga magulang sa kanilang mga anak? How to give the heart and will up to Christ. This is how the power of Satan is broken. Kapag natuto yung mga kabataan to surrender their will and their heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. So now let's dive directly into our subject. What is the example of Jesus Christ? What is his example? Now, you can actually keep on holding that text in 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 21 because I'll just be reading the rest. So you can put your ribbon there and mark that text. Notice this one. The question is, what is the example of Jesus? But this time, instead of quoting from the King James Version, my favorite version is the King James Version. But this time, I would want to show you how ISV rendered it. International Standard Version. Let's read this together. Let's start. He never sinned and he never told a lie. When he was insulted, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he did not threaten. It was his habit to commit the matter to the one who judges fairly. What was our question? What is the example of Jesus? And according to this text, at least just according to this text. Now, if you read the Bible, you can see a lot of examples of Jesus Christ. But let's just focus on this. It's already enough to consume our 1 hour for today. He never sinned, never told a lie. He was insulted, he did not retaliate. He suffered, he did not threaten. Again, let me outline it for you. The example of Christ are the following. Number one, he never sinned, he never told a lie. Number two, ano ang sabi? He was insulted, he did not retaliate. Kumusta naman tayo dyan? Papangiti na lang tayo. Sabi niya, sana all! Okay. Patuloy muna. Next!
He suffered. He did not threaten. Okay. So we have here at least 3 points. He never sinned. He never told a lie. He was insulted. He did not retaliate. He suffered. He did not threaten. Now let's break this down and see. Because the question is, in our study today, we're not just going to talk about the what. A lot of times when people study about Jesus Christ, they focus on the what. What is the example of Jesus? What did he do? What this? What that? But in our time today, I'm not going to focus on the what. We are going to focus on the how. Are you excited for that?
Yes.
Right. How? Let's start. How did Jesus endure insults and suffering without retaliating or making threats? Kasi when we think about ourselves, parang alanganin yan, brother. But the question is how? Since Jesus is our example, how did he do it? Perhaps we can get some idea on how we can do it too. So, the answer to this question is also found in the text. Look at the text again and notice it carefully. 1 Peter chapter 2 verses 22-23. He never sinned and never told a lie. When he was insulted, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he did not threaten. Let's read together the text in bold. It was his habit to commit the matter to the one who judges fairly. Oh, yun pala yun. How was Jesus able to do this one? Even though he is insulted, he did not retaliate, hindi siya lumalaban. Even though he is suffering, he does not threaten. Jesus was able to do this because it was his what? Habit. What is his habit? To commit the matter to the one who judges fairly. Here's a commentary. Albert Barnes notes on the Bible. The meaning is that he committed his cause, his name, his interest, the whole case to God. Binigay niya lahat sa Panginoon. He gave it all to the Lord. The meaning of the phrase that judgeth righteously here is that God would do him exact justice. So in other words, the reason why Jesus did not retaliate, the reason why Jesus did not threaten, because he understand this is not my battle. Yes, he received the hits. He was hit. But then, he gave it to God. His cause, his interest, he committed it to the Lord. That is his habit. In other words, Jesus avoided retaliation or the necessity of retaliating because he did not take the matters in his own hands. He gave it to the Lord. Remember the last time that you fought? Remember the last time that we threatened? That was the time when you thought, kaya mo yan. But if we only realize sooner na hindi natin kaya and just give it directly to God, there will be less retaliation, there will be less threatening. Because it is all in the hands of God. Anyway, that's not actually the focus of our study today. Patikim lang yan. Because I would want us to focus into something that is heavier today. Let's remember the example of Christ. He never sinned. He never told a lie. He was insulted. He did not retaliate. And what's number 3? He suffered, but he did not threaten. Now we already know how, the how of number two and the number three. But I told you, that's not our focus today. Because the focus of our study today is the how of number one. What is number one? He never sinned. He never told a lie. I'd like to ask you a question, and I hope you will cooperate. Question, listen carefully. Who among you here wants to avoid sin? Raise your hands. Hindi ata narinig, ulitin ko. Who among you here wants to avoid sin? Taas ang kamay. Okay, hands down. Hindi lahat tumaas, tagalugin ko. Sinong dis sa inyo dito ang gustong iwasan ang pagkakasala? Taas ang kamay. Okay, hands down. Well, I just wanted to make sure na gusto ninyo. Because I would be quite worried kung ayaw ninyo eh. Ewan ko na lang kung kayo ay may asawa at yung asawa ninyo hindi nagtaas yung kamay. Maliligado yan, brother? That would be dangerous, right? If your spouse would say, ayaw kong iwasan yung kasalanan, issue yun. Now, let's ask the question. Let's keep on asking question now. Is it even possible to stop sinning in the first place? Baka kasi hindi pwede eh. Kasi sabi nga nila, bakit pa natin aasamin yung isang bagay na hindi naman natin makukuha? Why desire for something that you cannot have? Is it even possible to stop sinning? Well, I will not answer this question today, but let's see what the Word of God says. Is that okay with you? Hindi ko sasagutin. Magbabasa lang tayo. Okay ba? Alright. Is it even possible to stop sinning today? There are at least two places in the Bible kung saan Jesus Himself said, do not sin. John chapter 5 verse 14. This is Jesus addressing yung taong may sakit for 38 years at the pool of Bethesda, pinagaling niya yun. And later on, nakita niya sa temple yung taong yun. And Jesus told the man something. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Let's read together what Jesus said. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon thee. May warning. Jesus said, sin no more, lest something worse will happen to you. So this is one instance wherein Jesus said, do not sin. Here's another one, number two. Same book, chapter 8, verses 10 and 11. This time Jesus is talking to the woman caught in adultery. Sabi ni Jesus, when Jesus lifted up himself, and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, woman, where are those thine accuser? Hath no man condemned thee? She said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, let's read together, neither do I condemn thee. And what did Jesus say? Go and sin no more. Malinaw po ba? At least two instances in the Bible where Jesus Himself said, sin no more. Three words. Let's say it again. Sin no more. Again. Sin no more. Isa pa? Malinaw naman yun, di ba? If you open your Bibles, you will see it there. That's red text. When you see a red text in the Bible, that's words coming from the mouth of Jesus Himself, not some apostle, not whoever else. It's Jesus himself who said so. Jesus said three words. What did Jesus say? Sin no more. I have a question for you. Jesus would not tell people to do anything that is impossible to do, would he? Iutos ba ni Jesus na gawin natin yung isang bagay na imposible palang gawin? However, it's quite disturbing because nowadays, you can hear people, even within our church, that would say, it's impossible to stop sinning. And I often say, wherever you hear that, I just like you to know, that's a lie and that's not coming from the Word of God. Because Jesus himself said, what's the three words? Sin no more. Now, here's the caveat. I'm not talking about overcoming sin at the second coming. Because some people say, darating naman talaga tayo dyan. Hindi na tayo makakagawa ng kasalanan. We are going to stop sinning. When Jesus Christ will come, He will give us perfect character. We will not sin again. Really? Is that what the Bible is telling us? If you read your Bible carefully, that's not it. Look at this one. 2 Peter chapter 3 verses 13 and 14. This is from International Standard Version para madaling intindihin. But in keeping with His promise, we are looking forward for, what are we looking for? New heaven and a new earth. Okay, when are we going to experience that? When Jesus Christ will come, right? But notice this. Where righteousness is at home, so then, dear friends, if you are waiting, then, ganun yan. Then, dear friend, since you are looking forward to this, ano yung tinutukoy dyan? New heaven and a new earth. Since we are looking forward to this, ang sabi sa atin, make every effort, let's read together, to have the Lord find you. Ibig sabihin, gawin mo ang lahat so that when Jesus Christ will come, He will find you. Find us in what situation? At peace, without spot, or fault. So do we need to wait for the second coming of Jesus to stop sinning? According at least to this text, you don't have to. In fact, because you wanted to be in the new heaven and the new earth, make sure that He finds you. Ibig sabihin, hindi mo hintayin, tsaka ka palang magiging ganon. Ibig sabihin, dapat pag nakita niya, ganon ka. At peace, without spot, or fault. I'd like to remind you, my dear brothers and sisters, that when Jesus Christ will come, and our hearts and our minds are not ready, and we still enjoy doing sin, the wicked people are gonna perish at the sight of Jesus Christ. Hindi sila babaguhin ng Diyos. Sila ay... They're gonna perish. It says, and to you who are troubled, rest with us, when the Lord shall be revealed from heaven, when His mighty angels in flaming, taking vengeance on them that know not God and obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His power. The Word of God is very clear. If we continue in sin, and then abutan tayo, Jesus Christ appears in the air, we are not going to receive character. In fact, if we are not ready, we will perish in the presence of the Lord. That's very clear teaching from the Bible. So, let me ask you again. Listen, who among you here wants to avoid sin? Taas ang kamay. Okay. Para mas marami-rami ngayon.
I'm just kidding. I think I saw all of you raise a while ago. But anyway, let me ask a different question that is related to this. Ito, tiyak siguro, maraming magtataas nito. Siguro lahat talaga. Siguro lang. Ano ba itong tanong na ito? Okay, question. Listen carefully. Who among you here have committed at least one sin in your life? Raise your hand. At least one sin. At least isang kasalanan lang sa buong buhay mo. Kung nakagawa ka, no? Taas yung kamay. Okay, taas pa. Okay? Okay, hands down. Actually, mas kakabahan ako kung hindi ka tataas dito eh. Because that would be strange why someone like you are still here. Here's a fact. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Sigurado yan. None of us are exempted. We have committed sin. But there is also something that is also a fact. Yes, it is true that all have committed sin, but there is something that is also a fact. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, it says, for we have not an high priest, talking about Jesus, who which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Jesus, although he was tempted in all points like as we are, like, what are your temptations? Jesus had those temptations and says he was without sin. Look at the text carefully. This is King James Version, di ba? Minsan kasi madali intindihin pag hindi King James. Okay, now I would like to show you ISV, International Standard Version. Hebrews 4:15. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. Jesus can relate with our weaknesses. You mean seriously? Yes, seriously. He can relate. He can sympathize with our weaknesses. And you say, even the human passion? Yes. Why? Because Jesus is God who became flesh. Siya ay Diyos na naging tao. God who became man. But even though he was assailed with this temptation and weaknesses, the Bible tells us that he never sinned. So that's a fact. And so now, let's go back to the question. How did Jesus avoid sin? Balik na tayo. How did Jesus avoid sin? Some people say, Jesus did not commit sin because he had a perfect and fallen nature. Sabi? Dito, nagiginig ka. What did Jesus, what some people say? They say, Jesus did not commit sin because he had a what? Perfect and fallen human nature. Sabi nila, ah, of course! Of course, perfect si Jesus! Kaya nagawa niya yan kasi he had perfect naman yung nature niya eh. He had unfallen human nature. Unfallen human nature. By the way, clarification. Ilagay ko dito sa note ko. I need to clarify something. We need to understand that there is actually an ongoing debate even among Seventh-day Adventists regarding the human nature of Christ. You know that? Yes. And the debate is between, did Jesus take an unfallen human nature? Ibig sabihin, nung nagpakatao si Jesus, what nature did he take? The nature of Adam bago nagkasala si Adam? Kasi naging tao din naman. Tao naman si Adam, di ba? So, some people would say, when Jesus became man, he became man just like Adam before he committed sin. Kaya, unfallen human nature. On the other side of the debate, they would say, Jesus took the fallen human nature. Fallen human nature meaning, pagkatapos magkasala ni Adan, yung taong, kasi ang ginagamit na text is, he is the seed of Abraham, the seed of David. So some people would say, okay, Jesus, when he became man, he took the fallen human nature. Sa Adventism, hindi na-issue yung Diyos pa si Jesus. Issue pa ba? Ang delikado kung issue pa rin. Anyway, I don't have time to discuss that. But I fully believe with all my heart that Jesus is 100% God. But at the same time, Jesus is also 100% man. Hindi 50-50 kasi kung 50-50, tigba lang yun. Hindi nyo nakuha yung joke, ha? Ba't tigba lang? Kalating tao, kalating tabayo? Hindi ganun si Jesus. Si Jesus, 100% God, 100% man. Hindi 50-50, delikado yan. So that's not an issue. The issue is, ano ba yung kanyang nature? Anyway, I have my own answer for that, but that's not my subject today. Regardless of what you think about what nature he took, I'd like to, for you to focus on the rest of the words that we're gonna study today. Because the reality is that even if we say, kasi sabi ng iba, kaya hindi nagkasala si Jesus kasi nga Diyos siya, di ba? Diyos, sabi mo nga, 100% God eh. Perfect nga siya, di ba? Unfallen eh. Kaya hindi nagkakasala kasi unfallen. Perfect. Okay. Here's the reality. Face it. Unfallen nature cannot make you avoid sin. Well, how do we know that? We know that very well. Why? Because Satan, the devil, perfect ba siya? Think. Sabi mo nga, gusto ko dito si Kaina kasi matatalino eh, di ba? Kailangan makita natin yun. Okay. When the devil committed sin, was he already fallen? No. When Satan committed sin, he was perfect. He was unfallen. In fact, if you're going to read the book of Ezekiel, it would say, you were perfect until iniquity was found in you. Ibig sabihin, at the point when he fell from perfection. Kuha? I mean, is that practical or masyadong theological?
Both?
Okay, baka hindi tayo makarelate kay Satan. Well, let's talk about Adam and Eve. When did Adam and Eve commit sin? When they were fallen or unfallen?
Fallen.
Of course! When Eve was tempted by the serpent, she was perfect. She was unfallen. But what happened to her? She fell. Dinamay niya pa si Adan. Sabi, kasalanan pa ng babae. Hindi rin. Kasi kasalanan din si Adan. Kasi nagpadala siya, di ba? Oh. But here's the point. An unfallen nature cannot make you avoid sin. Hindi ibig sabihin na unfallen ka, perfect ka. Ibig sabihin, disabled ka. Meaning, you don't have the ability to commit sin. You still have the ability to commit sin. Because sin is a choice. It has nothing to do with your nature. The devil chose. He was perfect. God made him perfect. May mali ba ang Diyos doon? Like, kulang pa ng tornilyo? Wala. Kulang ba ng balahibo si Satanas? I mean, he was perfect, but he committed sin. So the point is, you don't have to have an unfallen nature to avoid sin. It has nothing, nada, nothing to do with your nature. And here's point number two. Kasi sinasabi ng iba, pero Brother Kevin, iba kasi tayo ngayon eh. Anong iba? O kasi maraming temptasyon sa paligid. Okay? Marami ng temptasyon ngayon, hindi na katulad dati. Kaya si Jesus, ganun siya eh. Well, here's another point. Let's read this together. A perfect environment cannot make you avoid sin. Anong prueba natin yan? Ay, si Satanas pa rin! Why? Where was Satan when he committed sin? The Bible says he was in heaven. Is there a problem in heaven? May ibang ahas ba doon? Wala naman ang ahas sa kanya doon ah. Heaven was a perfect place. How about Adam and Eve? Perfect place. The garden. Ito magandang escalade pero wala tong patama doon sa garden. Malayo to. The Garden of Eden, what a perfect place. But then, still Adam and Eve committed sin. In other words, a perfect environment cannot make you avoid sin. So I hope we have established two very important points. Nature, yung kalikasan, yung likas, will not enable us to avoid sin. Even a perfect environment will not stop us from committing sin. Has nothing to do with that. Adam and Eve, Satan, they failed. Even if they had perfect environment, and even if they were in perfect condition. So do not think, nasa ka na lang ako, Lord, iiwas sa kasalanan kapag naging perfect na ako. Ibig sabihin ba, kapag perfect ka na, hindi ka natatablan? Tinablan nga sila, di ba? So, okay lang ba kayo?
Yes.
Eh, iba na, ganun na. I hope it's not too deep. So let's try to make this very, very practical. Let's go back to our points here. The example of Christ. Number one, He never sinned. He never told a lie. Number two, He was insulted. He did not retaliate. And number three, He suffered. He did not threaten. Our study is focused on number one. He never sinned. He never told a lie. Actually, yung iba, hindi ito yung issue eh. Ito yung issue. For some people, mas malaking issue ito. Because lying is so easy to do. Di ba? Anyway, let's just focus here. Kasi, yung lying under sa kasalanan naman talaga yan eh. So let's just focus on this word, sin. So let's go back to the question, hindi pa natin nasagot. Lapit na mag-alas 12, hindi pa natin nasagot yung tanong. How did Jesus avoid sin? How? Here's an amazing quote. Selected Messages, Volume 3, page 140. Yun yung picturean, kung gusto ninyo. It says, "And the Lord Jesus came to our world." Let's read this together. The words in bold, let's start. "Not to reveal what a God could do, but what a man could do through faith in God's power." Amen?
Amen.
This is the example of Jesus Christ. Not to show us what a God can do, but what man can do through faith in God's power to help every emergency. Man is through faith to be a partaker of the divine nature and to overcome every temptation wherein he is beset. Ang example ni Jesus is hindi example ng isang Diyos. Ang example ni Jesus ay example ng isang tao. A man who is through faith dependent on the power of God. That's the example of Jesus Christ. When we read the Garden of Gethsemane, this is where we can see the example of Jesus Christ. By the way, you can read about Gethsemane in Matthew 26, verses 36 to 42. I would not read that anymore, but I want you to take note of that. Because that is where Jesus showed us the example of how to overcome sin. But this time, because we don't have enough time, I'm just going to focus on key passages out of the Garden of Gethsemane. Matthew 26, verse 41. Jesus said, "Watch and pray." Ano daw ang dapat gawin? "Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Sabi ni Jesus, "Watch and pray." Ibig sabihin, magmasid ka. Huwag kang matulog. Kasi yung disciples niya natulog eh. Sabi ni Jesus, "Watch and pray. Wake up, stay awake, and pray so that you will not enter into temptation." So this is at least two keys to avoid sin according to Jesus Christ. Watch. Do not sleep. And when you are awake, what should we be doing? We should be studying the Word of God. The Bible says, "Thy word have I hid in mine heart so that I will not sin against thee." So studying the Word of God and praying, this is how Jesus avoided sin. Remember when he was tempted there at the desert? How did Jesus respond to the temptation? "It is written." How was Jesus able to do that? That means Jesus was familiar with the Word of God, so that when temptation comes, the Word of God just pops in his mind and he just speaks it out. "It is written." Watch and pray so that you will not enter into temptation. But I want you to notice something, because when I was studying this last night, and while studying this, tinapik ko yung asawa ko, sabi ko, "Dear, I discovered something!" Have you experienced that, Pastor? When you're studying the Word of God, and then the Lord showed you something very interesting, kaya tinapik ko si Mrs. ko, "I discovered something!" And it was when reading this text, because of the last phrase. Notice the last phrase. He said, "The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." You know the usual understanding? The common understanding kasi is ganito. Para bang sinasabi ni Jesus, "Okay lang yan, naintindihan kita. Willing yung spirit mo, pero weak ka kasi." Relate much? Diba? That's the common understanding. But when I read this text last night, I was so surprised. I couldn't tell. I have to tell my wife, "I discovered something." That's not what the text means. You know what it means? Here's a commentary. Albert Barnes notes to the Bible, "Though you may have strong faith and believe now that you will not deny me, yet human nature is weak and shrinks at trials. and you should therefore seek strength from on high. In other words, Jesus was not just saying, gets kita, weak ka kasi. No, Jesus is not saying that. Jesus is saying, watch and pray, because you are weak. Kuha? Continuing on. It says, this was intended to excite them. Ah, purpose pala nun is to not to comfort them, but to excite them. Notwithstanding, he knew that they love him. To be on their guard, lest the weakness of human nature should be insufficient to sustain them in the hour of their temptation. In other words, when Jesus said, watch and pray. Because even though your mind is willing, if you do not watch and pray, you will fall into temptation. So Jesus said, watch and pray. Jesus was not just trying to comfort them. Jesus is teaching them how to go beyond human nature. Amen? That's wonderful. And that dawned on me, kinilibutan ako eh. That hit different. Matthew 26:39. And he went a little farther, fell on his face, and prayed, saying, O Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. You know what? At this point, this is the human nature of Jesus. Kasi nung pinatong sa kanya ang bigat ng kasalanan ng lahat ng tao sa buong mundo, mabigat pa yung kasalanan ng tao. I mean, think about your own sin. Think about it, the sins that you have done. Okay, pause na. Baka maalala mo pa lahat eh. Okay, at this point, tanong, kamusta ang pakiramdam mo? Mabigat ba? Mabigat! Hindi mo pa nga naalala lahat eh, mabigat na. Yung kahapon pala, mabigat na, di ba? Baka yung kanina, but think about it, na kasalanan ng buong mundo, hindi lang isang tao, kasalanan ng lahat, ipinatong sa kanya. Pinasan niya lahat yon. And in his human nature, he said, Father, if possible, anong Tagalog niyan? Kung pwede lang. Kung pwede. If possible, let this cup pass from me. Itaan mo na ito sa akin. Lampas mo na, Lord. That was his human nature. But you know, how was Jesus able to overcome? Was Jesus victorious at Gethsemane? Oh, yes. Akala niyo yung laban sa cross, hindi. Yung laban sa Gethsemane pa lang. It was at Gethsemane when Jesus overcome. Because Jesus said something at Gethsemane, and this is how he overcame it all. Jesus said, nevertheless, let's read this together. Not as I will, but as thou wilt. Amen? Amen? In other words, Jesus did not commit sin because he was entirely surrendered to the Father. Ito na yung sagot sa ating tanong. What was the main question? How did Jesus avoid sin? So the answer to that is because he was entirely surrendered to the Father. More passages. John 5:30. I can of mine own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is just because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father who hath sent me. That is the example of Jesus. Hindi siya nakadepende sa kanyang sarili. Kung sa Bisaya, pawas siya gasalig sa kaugalingon. Hindi siya nakadepende sa sarili niya. He was surrendered to the Father. Next, John 6:38. For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. Wow. So this is how Jesus overcame. Because although he's really saying, Lord, ayaw ko na, but he was willing to surrender and said, not my will, but your will be done. I remembered someone, nagpaalam. Sabi, payagan niyo akong pumunta doon. Ang sabi sa kanya, wag, kasi mapapahama ka. Anong ginawa? Ay kung ayaw niyo pala, lalayas na lang ako. In other words, the person commits sin. We commit sin when we don't surrender to the will of God. When we try to follow our own inclination, that's when we commit sin. Philippians chapter 2 verse 8, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. How was Jesus able to become obedient unto death? Because he humbled himself. He did not depend on himself. He humbled himself. Okay, let's dive deeper. Oh, may lalalim pa pala yun. Meron pa. Okay, ito. Now, you might be thinking, yeah, okay. I understand the point. Jesus surrendered. Okay, ano ngayon? Eh, sumurrender nga siya, pero makapangyarihan naman siya. And that's why people think, oh, Jesus was able to overcome because he was powerful. Powerful siya. Eh, how about me? Ano naman ako? Powerful. Jesus yan. Jesus, of course. Perfect nga, di ba? Okay, let's hit this. Are you ready? In theology, there is a concept called kenosis. Parang sakit. Parang kapatid ng arthritis, no? Arthritis, diabetes. Pero hindi yan sakit. Kenosis. A kenosis. Gusto niyo yung slang? Okay, ano ibig sabihin ng kenosis? Okay, kenosis. O, take note nyo na lang. Mamaya nyo na i-Google. Baka iba pa makita nyo dyan eh. Okay. Kenosis is a religious term that means giving up something. Giving up something. Kenosis. Ibig sabihin, kenosis is the study of what Jesus gave up to become like us. Okay? Kenosis. Oh, sige, baka puro kenosis lang maalala nyo eh. Tuloy tayo. What did Jesus do so that he can become man? The concept of kenosis is based on Philippians chapter 2 verse 7. This time, I am quoting from literal translation of the Bible. The literal translation of the Bible. Let's read this together. Let's start. But emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, having become in the likeness of man. Kenosis. Para maging tao si Jesus, anong kanyang ginawa? According to the Bible, so that he can take the likeness of man, he emptied himself. He emptied himself. Okay. Comment. The example of Jesus is entire surrender of the will and complete dependence on God. That is the example of Jesus. Kasi si Jesus, when he came here, he did not depend on his own ability. He did not depend on his own power. He was completely dependent upon God. And that is the example of Jesus. John 5 verse 30. Let's read this together. I can of my own self do nothing. Wow! Hindi sa sarili niyang kapangyarihan. Jesus said, I can of myself do nothing. Yes, Jesus himself said that. Read your Bible, it's there. I give you the text. It's there. Jesus said, I cannot do of my own self. As I hear, I judge. My judgment is just because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which has sent me. So you have two surrenders there. Surrender of the will and what? The surrender of his own abilities. Because he said, I cannot of my own do. Here's another text. John 14 verse 10. Believest thou not that I am the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself. But, let's read this together. But the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. The example of Jesus is not the example of inherent power. The example of Jesus is the example of complete surrender and complete dependence to the Father himself. Jesus said, the Father dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Next, Luke 4:18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Anong nangyari? Because the Spirit of God is with him. It says, because he had anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, he sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them which were bruised. These are miraculous activities, di ba? How was Jesus able to do this? Because he has inherent power at that time? No. It's because of the power of the Holy Spirit. Acts 10, verse 38. How God anointed Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. So how was Jesus able to perform good things? Because he received the Holy Ghost, and together with God, he had power from the Holy Ghost. So, let's go back to our points. And as we come to our conclusion, let's read this together. The example of Jesus is not reliance on inherent power. The example of Jesus is what? Entire surrender of the will and complete dependence on God. Amen?
Amen.
That's how Jesus was able to avoid sin. Not because he had a special nature. Not because it was impossible for him to sin. It was possible for him to sin, but he did not sin because he was entirely surrendered to the Father and he was completely dependent on God. And this is the example that he wants us to follow. This is completely different from the concept of several religion today. For example, if you're familiar with Buddhism, what is the concept of Buddhism? You explore yourself, you discover that inherent power of yours, and the sooner you discover that, the better. In fact, when you look at, if you're familiar with animes, ano bang makikita sa mga anime? Ano ba yun? Pupunan ng power, lalabas ang galing yung power sa loob. Inherent power. That's why they're able to do things. But that is not the example of Jesus. The example of Jesus was complete surrender and dependence on God. Again, the example of Jesus is not reliance on inherent power. The example of Jesus is entire surrender of the will and complete dependence on God. 1 Peter 2:21, For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps. We already know the example of Jesus. What's the example of Jesus? Entire surrender and complete dependence. This is the example that God wants us to follow. He set the example so that we will follow his steps. In fact, in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, you can go there now. We'll switch our study here. Philippians 2, verse 5, it says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." What is this kind of mind? What mind is this that we must have? It says, verse 6 to 8, "Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but," what's the example? "Made himself of no reputation." This is what was translated as emptied himself. Kenosis, remember? "And took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross." What is the example of God? What is the example of Jesus? The example of Jesus, yes, he did not sin. But his real example is how he was able to do it. Jesus avoided committing sin, not because it was impossible for him to sin, not because he had a special nature, not because he had inherent power. Jesus avoided sin because he was entirely surrendered to God and he was completely dependent on God. So, what will happen as we empty ourselves and surrender to God? What will happen? Just like what happened to Jesus. John 1 verse 12, "But as many received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." Amen? When we surrender ourselves, when we empty ourselves as well, just like the example of Jesus Christ, the promise is that he will give us power to become the sons of God. In other words, he will give us power to avoid sin. Amen? Not just that, because he will not just give you power, there's something even more special that he will do. According to the Bible, Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, "I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless," let's read, "I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." So, dear friends, Jesus will live within us. What do we need to do? Empty ourselves. Surrender everything to the Lord. Just like when Jesus emptied himself, he received the Holy Spirit. And the Father was working through him. And that is the same thing that will happen to us if we empty ourselves and have complete surrender to God. Jesus will come and he will dwell within each one of us. Amen? This is the great promise that we can all claim. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4, "Whereby are given us exceeding great and precious promises, that by this you might be partakers of divine nature." Amen? Yeah. Wow. There you go. You can partake of divine nature. You don't have to wait for the second coming. You can do it now. All you have to do is to apply these promises in your life. Surrender completely, empty yourself, and become fully dependent on God. This you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. The last text I would leave with you, Jude, verse 24. Oh, one chapter lang kasi yan. Okay, Jude verse 24. Let's read this together. "Now unto him," that is Jesus, "that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy." The promise of God is that Jesus is able. Yes, we are not able. Yes, we cannot do it on our own. That's why the key is in overcoming sin is complete surrender to God and complete dependence on God. Empty yourself. Allow Jesus Christ to dwell within our lives, and then His promise is that He is able. Do you believe that Jesus is able?
Yes.
What is He able to do? It says, keep you from falling. AKA, He is able to make you avoid sin. Amen?
Amen.
And not just that, it says, He is able to present you faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. And so, dear friend, as we conclude our study, would you like to tell the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, you know me. You know how sinful I am. And you know me, Lord, a lot of times I depend on my own ability, capabilities. But if you'd like to say today, Lord, help me to just surrender everything to you. Dwell in me and change me. Is this your desire today?
Amen.
You'd like to tell the Lord Jesus, Lord, make me willing to completely surrender to you and to be fully dependent to you. If this is your desire, can you show this by raising your hand? Amen. The Lord can see us and He will guide us. Let me pray quickly. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you so much for your word. And thank you so much for showing us the example of Jesus. The example of Jesus is not reliance on inherent power. But the example of Jesus that He wants us to follow is to be entirely surrendered and to be completely dependent upon God. Forgive us, dear Lord, for the times that we depended on ourselves. And now, dear Lord, make us willing and enable us to experience the life of Jesus Christ. We invite Jesus Christ to dwell within us today, change us, and bless us all. In the loving name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.